For more than 2 years, hundreds of employees at Apple were working on what eventually would be known as the iPhone. They couldn't talk about it with anyone, not even their families. Their creation would change the world.
It was a cluster f- sorry. You can beep that out. iPhone as a product never should have succeeded. When you make a new laptop, you make a new desktop, whatever, you start with a thing that works. You change the screen, maybe add a new little feature here and there, but that's it, you're done. iPhone was brand new from the chip up. We started with an operating system that had never been written to use the instructions on this particular chip. And on top of that, we put a new way to interact with your phone, with your fingers. On top of that, we had built a whole new set of applications. We had to write everything from scratch. We hit problems in every layer of every stack. It was a nightmare. And we almost actually didn't ship a couple of times.
The iPhone is arguably the most transformative piece of technology of the modern era, but its development was fraught with challenges. Andy Grignon was there from the beginning.
I was an engineer. I was a senior engineer. I'd written a bunch of software for the Mac, and I'd partnered up with my buddy Tony Fadell, and he had something cooking. He couldn't really talk about it yet. And what we ended up kind of prototyping in the early days was this iPod. Remember the click wheel iPod, right? So, you know, play, pause, next, previous, that kind of thing. Imagine that same device, but 0 through 9, A, B, C, D, E, F, all the way around in a circle. And you dialed and texted like a rotary phone. It was as awful to use as it sounds, but that was our first attempt at making a phone.
The year was 2005. That was one of the first iPhone prototypes. It would be another year and a half before it would finally be revealed to the world. Thankfully, another team at Apple was working on developing advanced touchscreen technology. It was meant to be used in a tablet PC. Steve Jobs had smaller plans for it.
We had acquired a company called Fingerworks. They had this really cool technology where you could type with your fingers on a thin membrane keyboard that had no actual keys. It had like little squares on it. You could just tap with your fingers. And somebody had the cool idea to marry that touch technology with a screen, and that completely changed the entire device.
But that big touch screen left room for little else. BlackBerries, the smartphone standard at the time, were revered for their physical keyboards. But some at Apple wanted to go a different route. Grignon's buddy Tony Fadell led one of the teams working on the phone project.
The keyboard was absolutely the biggest decision that we had to make, whether it was going to have a hardware keyboard or whether it was going to be a software keyboard. It would never be as good as a hardware keyboard, but without the hardware keyboard, there were so many other benefits that you would have for all the apps and the software and the general interface. So you really had to make a big, bold trade-off between what everybody said was the best thing in the world, which was the hardware keyboard, and then removing it.
In the end, Steve Jobs decided the trade-off was worth it. That decision would change personal computing forever.
If we didn't do what we did and really take the risks we did, maybe keyboards would still be around today. Maybe not, I don't know, but I think they had a better chance of surviving if it wasn't for Steve and his bold vision.
None of this really could have happened without Steve Jobs. In order to build the iPhone, you essentially had to bet the company.
Fred Vogelstein literally wrote the book on Apple and Google's war to dominate the smartphone market.
He essentially had to shut down all product development on everything else and suck all his most talented engineers into this one project. So if the iPhone had failed, there were no other products in the pipeline that Apple could have fallen back on.
If Jobs wasn't willing to bet big, the iPhone may never have made it to your pocket. But Grignon says that same bold leadership led to an interesting work environment.
My business card, my title is Chop. And it was a nickname that Steve gave me when I was building this product called iChat. I was Chop, fat dumb. You see a theme.
It wasn't just playful nicknames. Jobs was known for his strong opinions, even on seemingly small decisions.
We met with Steve in the boardroom, and Steve is just going to town on Tony about whatever it was. And Tony, I remember, he just kind of slinks down a little bit. And by the end, Tony's head right above the conference room table. And I was like, what the hell is going on here? And that's just the way the whole project played out. You know, there are times when Steve yelled and did whatever. And then there were times when you got into the territory where we didn't know if we had the expertise to solve this particular problem.
And Andy says it was those times that the iPhone team was most concerned.
Those were the times when Steve went from raging lunatic screaming and yelling and berating everybody to sitting in his chair. We had these like rocking chairs, and him and Tim Cook, you know, they sat like on opposite chairs, and they would like rock in sequence with each other. It was one of the weirdest things I'd ever seen. And those were the times when you were most terrified of all. It wasn't him screaming and yelling, yeah, fine, I got that. But it's when he shut the hell up and was just had this pensive look, and he was just contemplating, and you knew that we were all in trouble.
It's important to remember what Jobs was trying to do here. He wanted to put the experience of a desktop computer into your pocket.
On one hand, while Jobs's reason for doing the iPhone was that everybody hated their cell phone, that didn't automatically mean that you could then just go from making computers to making cell phones overnight. One of the top executives at Apple talked about the iPhone project as like the moon mission. Just developing the touchscreen would have, for most companies, been a very, very difficult single project to take on. The other thing was that they took a piece of software, OS X, which was running Apple's big computers, and figured out a way to shrink it so that it would fit inside the iPhone. Nobody had ever done anything like that before either.
But eventually, through all the work, through all the problems, and all the drama, the iPhone team had a prototype.
I had the prototype with me in my car. And back then, this was probably 2006. The way you got around wasn't generally by GPS. You'd print out directions on where you were going. And I had to go someplace, and I didn't print out my directions, and I was lost. And I remember I was stopped at a stoplight, and I was like, oh my God, I've got my prototype. So I went to Safari, and I went to MapQuest, and I found out the directions, and I had them. I was like, oh my God, this thing's actually pretty cool. This is the first time that I ever felt like we had a really interesting product on our hands.
Andy was one of just a few allowed to take a prototype off of Apple's campus. Tony Fadell was another.
I was on a flight, landed in Germany, and then ran down to go get my bags to get to my meeting that I had to go to. And as I'm getting the bag, I'm feeling in my pocket, I'm like, where is the phone? And I was like, uh-oh. I had to marshal a team of people to go search the plane. I'm like, it's a black thing, you know, it looks like a piece of glass on one side, plastic on the other side. It's about, you know, a little bit larger than the size of a playing card deck. Please find this thing. I must have it. I have to have it. I need you to take me back there. And they eventually found it was in my seat, tucked between the seat cushions, to then extract the phone and bring it to me about, you know, a half an hour later. But, you know, that half an hour felt more like a month.
When it came to the iPhone, Apple's notorious secrecy was in full force.
One of the things that was incredibly difficult about working on the iPhone for members of the team, most of them had no idea who was working on what. Apple is a very siloed and segmented operation. As the project got going, Jobs started pulling engineers off of existing projects and pulling them into the iPhone. You would come to work on Monday, and all of a sudden, places that you used to access were all of a sudden off limits. The Coke machine or the conference room that you liked to use was suddenly behind locked doors because members of the iPhone team were working on it.
But when it finally came time to pull back the curtains and present the iPhone to the world, well, that brought a whole new set of problems.
Announcement day was, I think, probably one of the most scary moments of my life.
It's always a tense time when you start building something and you show it when every single component in there is new. Every piece of software, every piece of silicon, the touchscreen, all the applications, everything is new. And so there are millions and millions of things that could go wrong. It was choreographed down to exactly what you would press and when you would press it, because if you went off script, it was most likely going to die in some way.
I had actually brought a bottle of scotch. We're in the audience, we're watching the whole thing unfold, and we decided whoever was responsible for that particular, you know, chunk of the demo had to do a shot. And so after each chunk, like they're giving me a shot glass. I'm like, oh my God. By the end of the announcement, I had done like 6 shots of scotch, and I was hammered at the end of it. And I was like, oh my God.
We would have backups upon backups upon backups, so that if something died, you could pick up another one that was right next to it to continue the demo.
You know, we had never once seen a demo run through go as well as announcement day went through. There was a couple of small little things that nobody would ever see, but it was probably the best announcement ever that I'd ever seen and that I had ever been a part of. And so when you see that, the reaction, the crowd, it was unlike anything I think I'd ever been through.
And we are calling it iPhone. Today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone.
I think people thought that the iPhone was going to be an important device when it came out. But I don't think anybody had any idea about how revolutionary it was going to become over the course of the next 10 years.
I knew it was important. I didn't know if it was going to change basically the planet the way it did.
Did we expect the iPhone to be as popular as it is today? No. We expected, I think, a successful product. We expected millions of people to use them. Honestly, I don't know that I expected a billion people to use it. It's how you find jobs, it's how you communicate, it's how you do all these things. We had no idea that was the product we were trying to create.